today. We feel proud in continuing with our series of talk show with eminent speakers on board on our very own E4G talk show. I am Shavinder Kaur, the brand ambassador, the anchor of this wonderful power-packed global talk show series, hosted with a mission and a mission to showcase the inspiring stories and interesting discussion on varied topics to ensure great experience for the viewers. We are currently rubaroo with our guest on our very own E4G talk show on our E4G Adda. Achievers are not born talented, but they possess the attitude, I can do it. Well, that's what describes about our speaker, the guest speaker, Dr. Commander Prasanna. He's a retired naval officer who worked as an air traffic controller in the Indian Navy. She is one of the five lady officers who initiated the fight for the permanent commission for the women, which culminated on 17 March 2020 with a favorable judgment from the Honorable Supreme Court of India after 10 long years. Good evening, Commander Prasanna, and a very warm welcome to the show.
Good evening.
So good to see you on the platform, and I'm glad that I could host you today for the show. While continuing with the brief about our speaker, she is an exemplary motivator, excellent in conducting behavioral programs for the children. She had conducted adventure and leadership camp for the children of Sanic schools. She was a member of the adventurer cell of the Southern Naval Command, participated in trekking camps, parasailing and mountaineering. During her student days, she was state level table tennis player and an NCC C certificate holder. Commander Prasanna, there's so much that I would like to talk about you. And while I was reading your bio, there was so much that inspired all of us that you have done in short span of your achievement in your journey. She is also recipient of Inspiring Women of the Year Award from ASSOCHAM and Women Achiever Award by KNSS, an active social worker, heading Mahila Wing of an NGO, VDM, India on the Move, and executive member of Distress Management Collective India. Married to Mr. Balachandra Manikan, tennis coach, and of course, a mother of beautiful 13-year-old Bhavna, who is an avid dancer and artist. That's so wonderful to read about your bio. And once again, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
How are you? And I hope you and your family are safe and sound in this trying and testing time.
Managing.
Absolutely. So all our dreams can come true if we have the courage to pursue them. Truly, that's what describes about our guest today. I'm so eager to talk to you regarding many things, but my first question to you is obviously, how did you start your journey from a young lady officer to a journey that you're leading today?
I come from a very small village of North Kerala, Kasaragod, a place called Uduma, where we are not even allowed to come in front of male counterparts, male members of the family. So you can imagine the plight, what I have gone through over a period of time. And few incidents which I could narrate, which can be of a motivational instinct for someone. Like, I got my commission and I wanted to visit my grandmother. So during my academy days, the kind of training which we have undergone, it was really tough, and I had long hair when I joined the academy. The first available opportunity, I went out. After we got a small break, small liberty, I took a haircut, and after we finished our basic training, all of us looked really tanned and totally changed. So I wanted to meet my grandmother to convey this message that I am a commissioned officer and I got my stripes. So I wanted to explain and show to her that this is a pair of stripes which we are wearing. So my mother told, I need to travel from Cochin to my hometown. So there is a railway station called Payyanur, which is closest to Indian Naval Academy. So my mother said, the moment train crosses Payyanur, you need to change over to salwar kameez with nice dupatta, and please don't go in jeans and t-shirt. So you can imagine the kind of mentality and the orthodox culture which was prevailing over there. Now times have changed, like people have changed, a lot of children have come up, even people are coming forward, they are even cracking civil service exams, and very few ladies are coming forward to join armed forces. But yes, maybe my upbringing or my parents' greater vision to lead an independent life and quality life, that may be one of the factors which has culminated to achieve something to this extent in my life. Like my father was also an NCC cadet during his college days. He has graduated in chemistry. Thereafter, he took up a job in a fertilizer factory in Cochin. Maybe because of the limitation, he couldn't pursue further, though he completed his graduation in law. He couldn't take up legal profession, whatever reason. But he always wanted us to lead something, like take up something very different. And earlier days, what happens, the moment you finish 10th standard, you decide whether you want to go into science stream, art stream, whichever stream. And the recognized profession in the society was either you become a doctor, engineer, or a lawyer, or a chartered accountant. So naval life and life in armed forces for a lady was like unheard of. So only option to get more information about armed forces or anything for that matter, it was only library books or some article in the newspaper or meet someone who has gone through this phase. So during our time, it was like we couldn't find anyone because the entry itself started in 92. Luckily, I was a NCC cadet. Like during my fifth standard to seventh standard, I was into Junior Red Cross, which may be one of the factor which has realized me at the earlier stage to look around and extend support to the society. The basic qualities which has developed during those time to extend a helping hand, which I'm still doing. So thanks to my teachers who have guided me at that point of time during my school days and later in my NCC training, where we could go for various camps, stay in different place irrespective of language, food habits are different, the culture is different. Like I have attended more than 20 camps, and every time staying away from my house was a challenge. And you need to survive with the basic dal chawal, which is generally given in the fauj in the NCC camps also. You are forced to stay in the tent. The washroom facilities are very limited. So I had an opportunity to go through all these things during my young age, and also participating in various competitions along with the students from all over the country. And coming from a local school, I was not able to speak in English or Hindi. So that again, it was a challenge for me. So I realized that if I have to do something, if I have to come out of my state and take up something, I need to be more proficient in English as well as Hindi to a certain extent. So I started listening to the BBC, English news, reading editorials of the various newspaper, and depending more on libraries, improving my gender knowledge, participating in more extracurricular activities, which has widened my horizon, which helped me in improving and maybe grooming my personality with the help of. During my NCC training, my seniors have guided me to a large extent. They gave me a clear-cut picture about SSB procedures, and I was in a position to visit many naval ships as an NCC cadet. And during my SSB, the interviewing officer asked me whether I could name few ships. I was like, I could give 30 names, and the interviewing officer was really surprised that like I was a general candidate. I didn't appear through NCC or anything. And even there was a model of a small ship which was kept on his table. He just asked me, will you be able to recognize which ship? So I just gave him the specification, this particular class, this particular category. These are the new ships which have come in this particular class. So he was taken up by surprise because I was very much motivated to join Naval Navy through because of my Naval NCC. I have participated in ship modeling, parasailing and other activities. Why I chose air traffic control? Again, I was fortunate enough to get selected for parasailing as part of my NCC. So we were taken to INS Garuda, which is a naval air station. So we were asked to wait, and we were waiting for the clearance from someone. Who is the someone? Like, I was curious. I asked the person. He said, from the air traffic control. Only when the flights are cleared, the runway is clear, you are allowed to do the parasailing. So I just, out of my curiosity, I asked, are we allowed to go and see the control tower? So that person, seeing my anxiety, he said, yes, let me try. The duty officer that day was kind enough to allow us to come and take a look. And he explained what is an air traffic controller's job. So somewhere in my mind, I had a small idea. Yes, this is very unique job and it requires certain talent and concentration and alertness, which is something different. And I had a fair idea and I started finding out more about air traffic control profession. And that was there in my mind. And to my surprise, Navy opened vacancies for air traffic control branch, which was again, like I wanted to join air traffic control. So it just happened. Like I happened to do the parasailing, happened to visit air traffic control. So I had a fair idea about it. Thanks to my classmates and seniors who are in Navy, they gave me a clear idea about what happens in Naval Academy, whether I will be able to cope up. So what I did, like you need to do few activities to improve your physical fitness. So being a table tennis player, since I played up to state level, I had the opportunity to maintain my physical fitness to a certain extent. I'm not saying that I'm 100%, but at least I know if I'm able to do 5 kilometer cross country or whatever it is, like. Yes, we developed some stress injuries, stress issues. Okay, so my exposure to table tennis has helped me in a big way to maintain my fitness level and go through the academy activities, whether it was PT, parade or other activities to a certain extent. Yes, it was a rigorous training and we enjoyed every moment of our academy life, whether it was a group punishment, the putty parade which happened. Still remember the first day when we got a new uniform to wear during evening hours. It was a sari. Very few of us knew how to wear a sari. So they gave us a punishment, changing from sari to another uniform. So now we all have become expert in getting ready in within no time and maintaining our all activities, scheduling our activities. So the Navy life has made us to become a better person, very strong personality, and all my coursemates are doing extremely well in their respective field. So I still feel that given a chance in the next Janam also, I should wear white uniform only.
Wow, that's absolute loyalty to your profession. And I really loved hearing to your journey, a sweet journey, which you started from a very stereotypical family background where they expected you to, you know, not, you know, wear anything else but a suit or all that. And then My brother-in-law is the deputy commandant of the NCC wing. So I have closely seen the passing out parade, and a couple of, I had been fortunate to attend that. And it really gives the feeling that how, you know, the cadets are dedicated. And I can really imagine that all definitely has added to your, to groom you to a gentle lady officer. And that's a wonderful anecdotes that you've shared with us. And of course, your fitness absolutely is seen right away, and you look definitely very fit. So once a soldier, always a soldier, you know. So that really speaks volume about a soldier. Thank you so much, Commander Prasanna, sharing those lovely, you know, moments that I'm sure our listeners will enjoy and take few very important tips that how you should stay fit, inculcate things that will help you to, you know, pursue further in your career. Yeah, and while my next question is, you were instrumental in the Supreme Court judgment for the Permanent Commission, one of the officer. So would you like to share something about that? What was the initiating cause in, you know, Delhi High Court, and what were the post-judgmental implementations? Would you like to share something on that?
Yes. For a male officer, he can decide at the age of 17 whether, if he has decided to join armed forces, he can decide to join after 12th or after CDSE entry or as a short service. They have an option to take up the career at respective age group and of their particular age, and take up armed forces accordingly, like entry after 12th or after graduation or post-graduation, or as a permanent or a short service officer. So as a lady, we were only given opportunity to join as short service officer during those time. And initially our commission was for 7 years, extended to 10, 12 and 14 year out. No pension, no ECHS, only gratuity. So what we realized that the ladies who wanted to take up armed forces, they are not coming forward, because after 14 years, after working at the prime time of their life, there is no assurance, there is no security to continue further. Getting a second career was absolutely difficult for all of us. Like, I was an air traffic control officer. The course which is given by Navy, we did our ATC course with Air Force. This is not recognized to take up a job outside. Only we can go into some administration job, not as a controller. So these factors will be there at back of our mind. And when we finished 14 years, when a new joinee asked us, what is the future outside? There is nothing. So we wondered that the policy which is existing has to be changed. Our fight was not against Indian Navy. It was against Union of India towards change of policy, so that more men and women can take up armed forces as a career. And I'm sure if they open entry for NDA, the eligible candidates from the ladies' side, whoever can clear SSB, whoever can complete NDA training, they can go up to the rank of admiral. And in the near future, we all are hopeful to see a lady admiral. So give us an opportunity, we will perform. It is not key, we say that, yes, we have biological restrictions, so that more and more young generation can be benefited. We were not sure whether we will get a verdict, whether it will be in favor. We never had a clue whether even the case will come up for hearing in during our span of life. Like, we have been hearing that if once you enter Supreme Court, it is lifetime. So we took a chance, and Air Force lady officers got a favorable verdict in 2010. That motivated us to join hands through a social media group, Facebook, in fact, those days. And we initiated, subsequently, many serving officers joined hands finally, when the final verdict came, it was beneficial for many lady officers as well as male officers, and it continues. Though the implementation part, it is still not done properly. And our main request was that as a male officer, he has an option to take it as a short service or a permanent commission officer. He can either join through National Defence Academy or Naval Academy and build up his career. For a lady officer, she should complete her graduation / post-graduation, complete her SSB, compete along with the male officers. And let me tell you, unlike Air Force and Army, Naval Entry Scheme is a combined SSB. It is not a women special entry scheme. In my particular branch, during my time, there were 7 vacancies, of which 6 are lady officers, and we had only 1 male officer. I'm very happy to announce that we lady officers have done much better than male officers in the selection. And all 14 of us are doing extremely well in our particular branch. Sorry, our batch. So our fight, when we continued, we had a lot of reluctance from various sides, like you're fighting against organization where you worked, you're fighting against Navy. So I said, no, it was not against Indian Navy. It is against Union of India for the change of policy. Finally, it has culminated that for us, since we were not reinstated, they have quoted a policy letter which was subsequently quashed. The court has ordered a compensation for 5 of us and full pension, which Navy has not granted. There is a lot of discrepancy in implementing the Supreme Court order, which we have again filed an application, and hopefully that will be settled soon. So our request in the court and our prayers, like, we wanted more and more women officers to come forward so that India should progress. If we can have Kalpana Chawla, if we can have Sunita Williams, why not women officers? Like in the year 2000, I was given an opportunity to sail on board a Singapore ship, which was commanded by a lady officer. The operation officer was a lady officer. A small country like Singapore could do that much progress 20 years ago. What are we talking? Where are we? Such a huge population, such a huge caliber in our country. Why should our ladies go abroad and work for other country? Why can't we have our people working for our own country? We wanted more and more people to join armed forces. We want our country to progress. Earlier days, when we talk about the war or any other scenario, it used to be physical war, and like people have to literally go. Now everything has changed. Electronic warfare, strategic planning. So all these things doesn't require that kind of a physical strength or whatever it is which they are talking. So according to me, it is again the mindset of Indians should change, and more women should come forward. The male members should accept the caliber of lady officers, and they should be allowed to function, and they should be given equal opportunity and support to grow. So this was our main motto behind filing a case, and I'm sure at least 80% we have succeeded.
Absolutely, Kumari Prasanna, it's a commendable efforts which we put in, because I am very closely from the army fraternity. While my husband was commanding, we had 8 lady officers, and we absolutely felt very proud, because for us they were officers, for my husband they were officers, and they all did exemplary in their profession, and all of them are very happy. Most of them have got permanent commission. So I'm sure the spark somewhere which was ignited by lady officers like you all have benefited many young lady officers. It's a commendable job which is done. We got to understand the real power comes in empowering others, and you all were absolutely you all have achieved that. So I'm sure you all must be feeling very proud, fighting for a cause which will in turn help many young officers. So absolutely commendable. Another thing I was just going to ask that question, but well, you have already answered that. You know, you must have faced many challenges while you were deciding to, you know, in the court to, you know, talk about against your organization. Well, I'm sure it must have been difficult. People must have said, "Arey, tum apne hi organization ke khilaf kyun khade ho gaye ho?" So, aise bahut sari situations aaye honge. But kudos to you and your friend circle and your you know, colleagues. When I'm talking to you, I'm really getting those goosebumps, you know, that you are a true soldier and how you wanted, and I'm sure the way you're inspiring. So do you think that, you know, we our struggle towards permanent commission in Indian Navy for women officers should bring importance in the Navy? And what are your, you know, suggestions for the young officers who should, you know, take it a pride to serve the Indian Navy and of course the armed forces?
If you have that passion to work for the nation, it's a wonderful platform. And I've realized over a period of time, we have gone through this series of pandemic situation, like recent floods in Kerala, then this COVID issues. We have realized one thing: you live for the day and lead a quality life, and live and die in a glorified manner. So if I can make some difference to the society by way of something which whatever I have earned, and to give back something to the society, I feel it is a good way of like I'll be very satisfied person in the earth. So it is not only about making money or going to various country or something. Yes, you need everything in life, but the kind of the satisfaction which you get if you are passionate to work in armed forces, by all means take up, prepare for your SSB, try, clear it, come in the merit list, wear that uniform, take pride in whatever you're doing. And like I still I don't miss watching any of the parades, like when I see the Rajpath march past and every other activity, even investor ceremony, when anybody getting recognized for their hard work, I feel so happy. Like I want more and more people to come forward, like, and we should have good people in our armed forces. It is my prayer that I want more and more people to come forward, and we should have best of the team in our country so that we all sleep peacefully at home. Yes, we have given our prime time, then now the next generation has to take over.
Absolutely wonderful. You know, all of us, it's a wonderful organization. Armed forces are absolutely, they've given us so much for all of us who have served the nation, are serving. I've got one daughter and I'm already, you know, she's in 10th standard and I'm already after her life that you should become an army officer like your dad, you know. So she says, why not, why shouldn't I join anything else? So I'm sure it's all there in our blood to be, you know, to be a part of organization. So do you think that, you know, should we impart compulsory military training in India? What do you say on that?
That helps our citizen to come up in a better way rather than getting into various other illegal activities, so that there is some discipline which sets in their life and they will not deviate. They will show some responsibility towards a family and nation if we provide them the compulsory military training. Mostly young youth, they generally get into other activities because of ignorance, lack of money, and due to other circumstances. But when you have a streamlined compulsory military training, yes, you have been given the, you have been taught the value of life, human life, and very many basic principles of life. Once you are very clear in your mind, I don't think anyone will get into any other illegal activities. They all will lead a proper life. And they all will look forward to support the society, and which is very essential for this our country.
Absolutely, Commander Prasanna, very aptly expressed. And see, there's so much that I want to talk and have a continued conversation, but time, of course, is the constraint presently. Quickly, I want to, ask, since it is a women's special edition, some takeaway for our young generation, especially the women, the young ladies, the girls. What would you like to tell them, you know?
I'm sure you all agree with me that ladies have the multitasking ability. Utilize it properly and do the best of it. Do something better for the family as well as the nation and for the society. Yes, time management is very important. You need to have space and time for your family, your society, and your people. But utilize it very properly and lead a very good quality life. That is more important.
Absolutely. And wonderful three important tips that you've told, you know, focus yourself, time management, and women have a lot of potential. They can absolutely multitask. Beautifully explained. Thank you so much, Commander Prasanna. It was wonderful to host you for a show, and we are absolutely looking forward for another conversation in times to come. So I would just like to say a few things for you. Keep your eyes on the stars and your feet on the ground. Well, that is Commander Prasanna. Courage above all things is the first quality of a warrior, and you have exhibited at all stages of your life. There is no limit to what we as women can accomplish. Thank you once again, Commander Prasanna, and we wish you all the success in future endeavors. May God bless you. Stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Jai Hind, absolutely.
E4D Talks is brought to you by ISECI, Indian Ex-Defence Service Employees Chamber of Commerce and Industries. Thanks to its vast veteran network and global and pan-India associates, ISECI can carry out various commerce facilitations and CSR projects across India and the world. Some of ISECI's core capability areas are Skill India, Atmanirbhar Bharat, Digital India, any ex-serviceman welfare or job program, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan related projects, telemedicine and healthcare training and job scheme, Save Water scheme, defense industry SME, MSME cluster and hub development, maritime training and inland water training with job facilitation, Canada study, job and permanent residency opportunity, e-commerce, Andaman and Nicobar commerce opportunities. ISECI's global reach includes countries like Indonesia, Slovakia, Canada, Nepal, Singapore, Rwanda, USA, UK. Above all, it is ISECI's effort to create a veterans brand made by the veterans, for the veterans, and made up of the veterans. Every Indian's support is invaluable in this journey. ISECI is a registered society for ex-servicemen's welfare and envisions that every veteran should be a part of India's economic growth story. It is the aim of ISECI to create an enabling commerce platform that will empower and synergize the veterans' talent pool. This is possible only with the support of entrepreneurs, businesses, and consultants from civil society. All proceeds, if any, are utilized for the welfare of ex-servicemen and for public charity.